Because you said you don't really need this degree. If it was revoked, I don't need the degree. So why did you come to Singapore in the first place if SG wasn't ready for the sex blog and now you're ready to give up the scholarship and you don't really need law because you have a business on the side. So why did you come to Singapore in the first place?
Well, I didn't exactly say that I don't need, you know, okay, the scholarship and the law place. But I would rather them not be revoked. Let's just leave it at that.
Why did you come to Singapore in the first place?
Back in 2004 or today?
No, back in 2004, yeah, the first time.
Oh, the first time was because my parents made me come here. That's just,
your parents made you come here?
Yeah, let's just put it that way.
You didn't want to come to Singapore?
No, I wanted to.
Okay.
I wanted to, definitely, but I was a little scared, of course. Because coming to Singapore was a big thing for me. I was just, you know, 15 years old,
right,
raw and green. But they told me to take up the challenge, and so I did. And at first, I struggled a lot in school, but then eventually I appeared. I came out as their top student. Mm. Yeah.
But recently, you wrote an essay or something like that on Facebook, saying that Singapore maybe isn't what you think it is, or saying that Malaysia is actually better.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not surprised that this got brought up because that note was being shared quite a lot online.
Okay.
The thing is that it's very subjective. Mm-hmm. It's like different strokes for different folks, to each his own, you know. Mm-hmm. I would say Singapore generally isn't my cup of tea. And I know this is not going to be a popular sentiment and, you know, netizens are going to call for me to be called, you know. But I would say that it's, I took a couple of sips and it's not my cup of tea.
Did you think people will think that's ungrateful because you got the scholarship and you came to Singapore, you lived there for so long, and then it's not your cup of tea?
Well, I don't think that gratitude should be solely expressed through me continuing to stay here. I think gratitude can be expressed in another way. And just because I don't want to stay here after graduation or after serving my bond, I don't think that means that I'm ungrateful, you see.
It does come across as you sort of like slamming the country that sort of like took you in, you know what I'm trying to say?
I know.
It may come across that way.
Yeah, I know it might come across as that way, but it is my life. I need to do what is best for myself, not caring so much about what the public thinks or even what Singapore thinks. I have to do what is best for myself. I have to live the life that I want to live. Whatever makes me happy, I will do it.
Do you think Malaysia is more accepting of your lifestyle?
I don't think so. Definitely not. Going by the sentiment on the internet, definitely not. There's a lot more heat on the online Malaysian websites.
Right.
From the moral angle, actually. A lot of it is, you know, saying that, you know, we're doing something that is so utterly shameful, utterly dirty, that we should not be allowed to live in Malaysia.
I mean, using this this fame to leverage and to get job offers, what jobs are you looking for from this sort of fame?
We don't know yet, but if we can narrow it down to industries, most likely something that, you know, something extraordinary. I don't think it would help us to be an accountant or a lawyer or engineer or anything like that. But maybe broadly, we are looking for something in the entertainment industry.
You guys mentioned that you guys want to be porn stars. To what extent is that true?
That is actually true.
Okay.
But it is more of a dream.
Okay.
A verbal vision, not something that we have a concrete plan for.
Okay.
Yeah. And then, so why study law or business in the first place?
Well, you know, that decision was made about 4 years ago, you see.
Okay.
So, you know, the education system is such that, you know, young 18-year, 19-year-olds, they are supposed to make their choice there and then. I think we tend to make a lot of wrong choices because, you know, we don't have all the information and we don't know what are all the options out there at that point in time. Yeah.
Was it a parental pressure to take up law? Or was it something you always wanted to do yourself?
Well, let's just say I just followed the typical Rafflesian standard operating procedure. Whenever a student graduates from RJC and intends to study locally, what they usually do is they submit multiple applications to medical school, first of all, definitely, and then law school next, and then dentistry school, and then chemical engineering, and then, you know, all the other choices are inconsequential. And whatever they're given out of these top four choices, they tend to take it. So that's what I did back then. Because I know knowing the law tends to be very advantageous as well, whatever field you go to in the future.
Okay, so future plans though?
Future plans right now is if I can continue to study in NUS come this January, I will do that. I'll continue to run my business on the side. And beyond that, I can't foresee anything. I'll take it as it comes. I will respond and react rather than proactively think of plans right now, because right now we have enough responses and reactions coming at us.
Right.
Yeah, and opportunities as well.
So what about Vivian? I mean, what's her plan? What are her plans?
I guess her plan is to lay low for a while, because in Malaysia, she tends to be the focus more than me, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, because after all, I was studying in Singapore all the while, and she was studying in the local MMU, you see.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's unprecedented, you know, open sex block in Malaysia. So I guess she has to lay low for a while. And I don't think she's going to actively try to do anything at this moment.
Do you think it will affect job prospects in the future, this whole debacle?
For
both of you guys, yeah.
The both of us, I think it largely depends how we explain it to our employers. Because employers tend to be very subjective as well. Unless they are very big employers like the government, who, you know, might be hot soup if they employ someone of my sort of character and history.
Right.
But I think in the private sector, it highly depends on you know, the employer's whims and fancies.
Okay, say for example, let's role play. Say I was a future employer.
All right. All right.
How would you convince me that what you did now was okay?
Okay, it was a moment of youthful indiscretion. Yeah. I haven't been involving myself in things like this for a very long time, and I hope that you will let bygones be bygones, and I will contribute my best I can to your company.
Okay. Excellent.
But you said that you are intending to continue, right?
Yeah, I'm not done playing the...
Oh, sorry.
No, I'm just joking.
Intending to continue with your blog and stuff like that in the future?
Yes, if there is a viable commercial opportunity to make a career out of it.
Okay.